Hello and welcome to Heringthorpe United Reformed Church service. Don't worry if you were expecting our minister Matt, he'll be along shortly. I think he was just looking to put somebody older to open the service so that it makes him look younger and even more fresh-faced. Please, I hope you don't mind the informality of the t-shirt. If you do, well, just be thankful you can't see my pyjama bottoms. We hope you're well, and we hope you're bearing up. Although we're apart and separate, we hope that today, through our worship, we will feel that we are part of one fellowship and one service. And let's just ask for God's blessing on this time now. Lord Jesus, we ask, although that we're separate and find ourselves in different places, we might feel, as St. Paul said, that we are all one in Christ Jesus, and we feel that oneness together today through this worship now. Amen. Well, we only have a few notices. Some pieces of paper were thrust into my hand just before I hit the record button, so I'll try and get through them as quickly as possible. First of all, coffee. Can you make sure that you wash your own coffee cups today, please? And this time, can you make sure you put them away as well? Thank you very much for that. Secondly, toilets. You probably not find that your toilet is off the corridor at the back today. You'll probably find that it's off the hall or off the landing, both if you live in a posh house. And if you live in a house where you have to run down the garden to go to an outside toilet, can I suggest you have a word with members of the Caring Fund Committee? They may be able to help. Fire alarm. We're not planning a fire practice today. So if you do hear an alarm, you've almost certainly burnt your toast. So take care there then, please. And then, oh, finally, yes, my last one. There have been some people who've commented that these recorded services do not perhaps carry that normal Heringthorpe atmosphere, that ambience, vibe. And if that's the case for you, then Paul Clarkson, who's our church member who is responsible for putting these recordings together, and he's doing a fantastic job, so thank you very much, Paul. But Paul will, on request, be able to provide you with a copy of the service with an additional soundtrack of a small child whining from the creche at the back of the church, or alternatively, someone playing the drums a bit too loud during the hymns. So if that appeals to you, just get in touch with Paul. Right, let's just have a few moments of quiet as we prepare ourselves for worship. And then we'll hear a few words from St. Paul as he wrote to the church in Ephesus. So let's just have a moment of quiet. Because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Amen. And now we're going to sing our opening two songs. The first is Holy God, Only a Holy God, and the second is Yes and Amen. So we're going to sing those now.
Commands all the hosts of heaven. Who else? Savior, you have brought me near. You pulled me from the ashes, you have broken every curse. Blessed Redeemer, you have set this captive free. Lord, I can't help but sing. Faithful you are, faithful forever you will be. Faithful you are, and all your promises are yes and amen.
Short time of prayer. Gracious Father, we come into your wonderful presence, knowing that we do not and cannot have a full understanding of your greatness and glory. We see us through a glass darkly. We have nothing more than a fuzzy picture of you, of who you are and what you are. What we do know, Lord, is that you are master and creator of all things. We know that you are unique and universal, a God present in this very moment and a God present in the future and the past, a God of time and a God out of and beyond time. In even our inadequate understanding of you, we recognize our insignificance. And yet we believe that in your sight, Father, we're not insignificant. That in your eyes, each and every person is precious. We're amazed by the fact that through your grace, we can have a relationship with you, the Lord of all creation. We praise you, Lord, for your majesty and greatness. And we ask you to remind us when we allow our perception to change, when we forget the unimaginable wonder of the relationship we find ourselves in. Forgive us, Lord, when we deny you in our words, deeds, or attitudes. We come to you now, Father, knowing we need to repent for the times we've harmed others through our speech and action, and through our failure to speak or to act. Lord and Father, renew a right spirit within us and encourage us to live through your strength and grace this week and into the future. Amen. And now we'll just join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
This reading is from Luke 16, verses 1 to 13. The Shrewd Manager. Jesus said to his disciples, "There was once a rich man who had a servant who managed his property. The rich man was told that the manager was wasting his master's money, so he called him in and said, 'What is this I hear about you? Hand in a complete account of your handling of my property, because you cannot be my manager any longer.' The servant said to himself, 'My master is going to dismiss me from my job. What shall I do? I'm not strong enough to dig ditches, and I'm ashamed to beg. Now I know what I will do. Then when my job is gone, I shall have friends who will welcome me in their homes.' So he called in all the people who were in debt to his master. He asked the first one, 'How much do you owe my master?' 100 barrels of olive oil, he answered. 'Here is your account,' the manager told him. 'Sit down and write 50. Then he asked another one, 'And you, how much do you owe?' 1,000 sacks of wheat, he answered. 'Here is your account,' the manager told him. 'Write 800. As a result, the master of this dishonest manager praised him for doing such a shrewd thing, because the people of this world are much more shrewd in handling their affairs than the people who belong to the light. And Jesus went on to say, 'And so I tell you, make friends for yourselves with worldly wealth, so that when it gives out, you will be welcomed in the eternal home. Whoever is faithful in small matters will be faithful in large ones. Whoever is dishonest in small matters will be dishonest in large ones. If then you have not been faithful in handling worldly wealth, how can you be trusted with true wealth? And if you have not been faithful with what belongs to someone else, who will give you what belongs to you? No servant can be the slave of two masters. He will hate one and love the other. He will be loyal to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money."
This is a really difficult parable. And if you're thinking, "I've really not got much of an idea what this is about," or "Is Jesus really commending dishonesty here?" you're probably not alone. I've been helped immensely by this book, Jesus Through Middle Eastern Eyes by Kenneth Bailey. And if you want to dig into the original context of a lot of Jesus's parables and teaching, I'd really recommend this. And one of the things that Kenneth Bailey points out about this parable is that we should look where it comes in Jesus's teaching, because it follows on immediately from the parable of the prodigal son. Now, if you're anything like me, even if you're reading the Bible through chapter by chapter each day, we often don't pay much attention to what comes before or after, but often it does shed a lot of light on what we're reading. And here, as we look at these two parables together, we realise that there are lots of similarities. Each has a noble master who demonstrates extraordinary grace. Each has an ignoble son or steward who wastes his master's resources. In each parable, the wayward son or the steward reaches a moment of truth about his sins. And in both cases, the son and the steward throw themselves on the mercy of the master, albeit in different ways. So it's possible that this parable is about the nature of God, about who God is and what God's like, and also about the nature of our lives as human beings and our brokenness, our sin. So let's have a closer look. There are three people or types of people in this parable. First of all, there's the master. And we can assume that he's a noble master, because if he was a scoundrel, you wouldn't expect people to come and tell him that his steward was a scoundrel. They'd think, well, it serves him right. That's what he's like. But the fact that they come and tell him suggests that he is a good master. And he's wealthy. He owns a lot of land. And like a lot of landowners, he has a steward, an estate manager who manages the properties. And that's the second character, the steward. He had a great deal of responsibility. A great amount of trust was put upon him. He was involved in running the estate day to day and handling the accounts. And it turns out that he's been using those resources poorly. He is not a good steward. And then the third group of people is the wider community. And they're not on the stage, but they're an important part of understanding the parable's message. Now, presumably somebody in that group, somebody in the wider community, has brought the steward's dishonesty to the master's attention. The master calls the steward in, asks him to give an account. The steward doesn't say anything. Perhaps his silence is a confession of his guilt. And he doesn't kind of say, well, I'm sorry. He doesn't kind of go into any of that. He's perhaps just thinking what he's going to do next, how he's going to deal with this. Perhaps he knows that the master's not going to be fobbed off with excuses. So he's fired on the spot and he's called to hand in the estate's accounts. Now, this really is his moment of truth. He says to himself, what shall I do? He says, I'm not strong enough to dig. I'm too ashamed to beg. Now, if we think back to the parable of the prodigal son, he could repent, couldn't he? He could go to the master and say, look, I've been an idiot. I've made lots of mistakes. Forgive me. Give me another chance. Look, my father, my grandfather, my great grandfather, they've all worked for your estate. Please, please help me. But he doesn't do that. And perhaps this parable is here to show us that there is an alternative response to the parables of the prodigal son. And that is to dig an even deeper hole, to go further. And if we're honest, we do that too, don't we? We cover up our lies with more lies. We refuse to forgive and bitterness eats us up slowly. We let our tongues run away with us and we excuse our gossiping as harmless. We justify our greed and our self-centeredness and we just carry on living as we've always done. Insert your sin here. You know, we all carry on sinning, don't we? You know, I know in my life that Jesus has been victorious over sin, and yet I still wrestle with sin on a daily basis. And sometimes sin begets sin, because sometimes we don't want to admit that we're in the wrong. We don't want to stop sinning. We don't want to put God on the throne of our lives over every part. So the steward comes up with a cunning and dishonest plan that will win him the favour of the wider community, and he hopes will secure him future employment. He calls in his master's debtors. Now, they don't know at this point that he's been fired. They think he's coming with the authority of the master to offer them these massive reductions in their debts. And they are really huge. They're about 18 months' wages. That's the amount that's being forgiven here. And so these debtors would return from their meeting with real celebration. The news would spread. What a generous master and what an amazing steward. Look at the debts that have been forgiven. They probably would have gone home and had a party. Now, after the deed's done, the steward returns the accounts to his master and the master realises what's happened. And he's got two choices, hasn't he? He could go and tell the village that the steward is a scoundrel and everything that he's just done is not valid. It's not legally binding because he'd been fired. The wider community must stop their partying and repay their debts in full. That would be the response of somebody who was just wanting to enact justice. Or the master can remain quiet. He can pay the price of this clever rascal's salvation and continue his reputation as a generous man. And he is a generous man because he dismissed the steward rather than having him sold into slavery or thrown into prison. That would be the response of somebody who wanted to prioritise grace. And that is the option that the master goes for. Now, it's important in parables that we don't overread too much into them about what God is like. But I think the point that Jesus is trying to make here is that grace is at the heart of who God is. That's not to say that justice is unimportant. We know that God is a God of justice. But God's grace comes to help us in that moment of need. And we see that most spectacularly on the cross of Jesus Christ. On the cross of Jesus, God's justice and God's grace meet in glorious display. There was still punishment for the sin. There was a price that had to be paid. But rather than that falling on us, on the perpetrators of sin and brokenness in the world, it fell upon Jesus. Jesus took the price of our sin. Jesus took the punishment that we deserved in order that we might be forgiven. Mercy and grace and love flowed into our lives in that moment. God's justice and God's grace come together. And here in this parable, that's exactly what happens. There's still a price to be paid. There's still a debts that have been forgiven that shouldn't have been, that the steward's kind of given out freely. The master himself picks up that tab. The master bears that cost for the sake of his steward and for the sake of us. I am always stunned by the grace of God. And I think as followers of Jesus, we should never lose wonder at the grace that we've been given. My favourite chapter in the Bible, or one of them, is Romans chapter 8. It talks so beautifully about all that God has done and God's love for us. And it says in Romans chapter 8, it says, if God will not stop at giving us his own son, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? In other words, if God would go to the lengths of letting Jesus die on the cross in our place, that we might be forgiven, how could we ever doubt that he wouldn't give us anything else that we need as well? And that grace, that amazing grace, is something that we need to let seep into our lives deeper and deeper, because grace is the antidote to sin. Not just in the sense that we keep on sinning and God keeps forgiving us, but in the sense that God's grace gives us everything that we truly need. And when we recognise that and we start to seek him and to trust in him, we stop seeking and trusting for satisfaction and for joy and for peace in other things that can never supply those things. It will stop us from drifting into looking for satisfaction, things that can't be given in our money, in our relationships, in our job, all those things that sometimes we put in the place of God in our lives. And in Jesus's teaching that follows on from this parable, he's particularly keen to emphasize that with regards to money, to mammon. You know, it's so easy for us, isn't it, to want to store up lots of material things, to have lots of nice material things to make our lives more comfortable, to have money in the bank to fall back on. But Jesus makes it really clear. He says you can't serve both God and money. There'll come a point where you're going to have to prioritize one over the other. And Jesus comes out with a pretty unique approach to financial management. Through this parable, he's saying that we should invest with eternity in mind. What really matters is not this life and how we live now. What matters is the life to come. What matters is life with God for all eternity in his kingdom. And just as the steward in the parable invested his money to try and win him friends later on, we should invest our money in a way that glorifies God and in a way that brings other people into the kingdom of God. We can give to bless and to invest in what God is doing. And we can do that because ultimately our money is not our money. Everything that we have is entrusted to us. We are like the steward, aren't we? You know, it's the master's estate. We simply manage the accounts sometimes. You know, we've got responsibility for what we've been given. But what we need to do is become a steward who invests with the master's intentions, the master's plans in mind. Will we be gracious as he is gracious? Will we pass on what we've received? Not for our own glory and comfort, but for his. When I was at secondary school down in Southend, we went on a day trip to France when I was in maybe year 7 or 8. As part of our French lessons, and we wandered around Boulogne and we attempted to speak to people in French in shops and cafes. We had a trip to a bakery where we made our own croissants and we also made our own French baguette. And as we left, we were given, I don't know whether it was our baguette, but we were given a baguette each to take home, and it was delicious. It was lovely and warm and just smelt fantastic. And as we sat on the coach on the way home, I couldn't help but get a little bit peckish. Many of you will know I've got a very good appetite, and that hasn't changed. So I started to nibble away at this baguette, but I didn't want to get home and not have something to show my parents. So rather than eat the outer bit of the baguette, the crusty bit, I sort of hollowed it out in the middle. And as the journey on the way home kind of continued and we were on the ferry and everything, I kind of hollowed out this baguette until when we got home, all I had was this sort of empty shell, which I showed my parents in delight, but they thought was absolutely hilarious that I'd obviously eaten it. There was nothing left for them to enjoy. And I wonder sometimes if that's what we're like as Christians. You know, on the outside, we can look like people of faith. That baguette still looked like a baguette, mostly, on the outside. We say all the right things. We turn up in all the right places. We believe what we're meant to believe, at least at a surface level. But if you push a little harder, you realise that there's not always a lot of substance beneath that outer facade that we portray to others. What we say doesn't always match up to reality, who we are and what we do. The image that we present to others isn't real, in other words, it's fake. Because although we present this image of being people of faith, in reality we struggle to trust God. We struggle to live for him alone. We struggle to let God be king of our lives. And this battle between serving God and money, or God and whatever it is for you that you might struggle with, you know, rages on within us. We want to do the right things, but time and time again we fail. It's like the joke, and this is a terrible joke, I'm sorry in advance, but it's like the joke about the balloon boy who has a balloon mum and dad, and he goes to a balloon school with a balloon, with balloon friends and a balloon head teacher. And one day this balloon boy decides to take a pin to school, which is of course a complete disaster. And he's called into the balloon head teacher's office, and the head teacher tells him, he says, "You've let me down. You've let your school down. You've let your parents down. You've let your friends down. But most importantly, you've let yourself down." It's a terrible joke. I'm glad really that I'm not in church and not hearing you all looking at me like I'm crazy. But that's us, isn't it? We let other people down. We let ourselves down. We let God down. And sometimes that sin keeps weighing on us. But what we need to hear today from this parable is that God is gracious, and he longs for us to come to him and to have our lives filled with his grace. That grace is not only kind of immediate medicine, if you like, it also heals us. It also helps to change us from the inside out. It really is the antidote to sin. And so we need to be praying for God to fill that empty shell of a baguette, that empty shell of our lives, with his grace, to be filled to overthrowing, that we might learn to trust in him more and more and more each and every day. None of us is going to become a great man or woman of God overnight. It's a process. It takes time. But we can keep seeking God. We can keep asking God to help us. We can keep longing for his Holy Spirit. And if you would like to start or to restart that journey today, then I invite you to pray for it, to seek our merciful Master and to hunger for his ways. Amen.
Sing with me, and can it be?
And can it be that I should again have an interest in the Savior's blood? Died he for me, who caused his pain, for me, who bid him to death pursue.
Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Heavenly Father, I come before you today in the name of Jesus Christ, and I bring before you, Lord, the petitions of our hearts. Heavenly Father, during this time of lockdown, during this time of isolation, things are hard for people of all kinds, of all ages. And Lord, we're coming to the end of our tether. People are losing patience. People are getting annoyed and cranky, and Lord, they just want to break out of this isolation and boredom. But you are God. You are sovereign. And as it says in the world, hear ye, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. You are not just one. You are alive. You move and you reign in the creation of your world. And so, Father, I just pray first and foremost for the leaders of our peoples, that you will give them wisdom during this difficult time. Give them understanding. Give them patience, Lord, as well. Give them good direction. For those of us in the church who long to meet together, but for whatever reason, at this moment in time, it is difficult. Father, I pray for those who are sick among our congregation, with all the ailments besides just the coronavirus. I pray that you will reach out a healing hand to them. You are the great healer. Jesus, when you walked the earth, you touched people. You spoke a word to them, and their bodies were healed. Their physical ailments disappeared. You even raised the dead. And I pray that through your Spirit now, you will move through this world and touch your people. In amongst all the stuff that's going on, what a joy, what great rejoicing there would be to know that miracles still happen, to hear of it, to see them. So undertake for them. I pray for our ministers of all the different churches, Lord, that you will give them wisdom as they have to deal with their congregation. You'll give them understanding. You will give them an undivided heart for your people, and not have little cliques and little groups of favoritism or people who sort of wield power from behind. But Lord, your ministers will know the righteousness of God, the governing of God, the power of God in their lives. And even though they might have to stand up to some people, wherever it might be, because we are, after all, human, and we like to have our own way, I pray, Lord, that you would put wisdom in the hearts of your ministers, that they'll be able to see for themselves the wider picture and be able to take action. I cover them in prayer, and I ask you, by the power of your Spirit, to work in them. What a joy it would be if we could say that all our ministers were Spirit-filled ministers. But Father, you, in spite of it all, are still in charge. You still rule and reign. So have your way. If there is any way that your church can help the wider world, I pray that you will give us opportunity. You will give us a willing heart, so that when things have changed and come about differently, the people will know, yes, there was a family of God that intervened in their time of need and were able to help. Lord, we want to hear you say on that day, inasmuch as you did it for the least of these, you did it for me. And so we thank you and praise you in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you very much for joining us in worship today. I'm going to finish with some words from the book of Romans, chapter 8. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble, or hardship, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. As we go from here today, may we trust in his grace and his love more and more. And you might like to stay watching for a few more minutes as we sing along or listen to the words of the wonderful hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Let's root ourselves in him. Let's let his grace and his love and his mercy and his kindness and his goodness flow over us and change us from the inside out. Amen and goodbye.
Come thou fount out of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, here by thy great help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Precious blood. Oh, that day when freed from sinning, I shall see thy lovely face. Clothed then in blood-washed linen, how I'll sing thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer tarry, take my ransomed soul away. Send thine angels now to carry me to realms of endless day. Oh, to grace how great a debtor, daily I am constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.